Hello, and welcome to day two of your Los Angeles Zoo's California Biodiversity Day celebration. My name is Elise Ollie-Brigoff, and I am an educator in the zoo's learning and engagement department. As a part of our celebration, today's events will focus on California Wild. We'll be learning about some of the wild creatures and wild places that are unique to the Golden State. Did you know that there are more than 160 native reptiles and amphibians living in California? Our guest today has encountered many of these and more on his herping expeditions around the state. Herping is the act of searching for amphibians or reptiles, and LA Zoo Curator of Reptiles and Amphibians, Ian Recchio, is a pro. Ian has worked in the herpetology department at the zoo for 26 years. He helped design and now manages the zoo's living amphibian, invertebrates, and reptiles facility, the Lair, which opened in 2012 and is home to more than 1,200 animals. Ian also leads the zoo's efforts to save the critically endangered and Southern California native mountain yellow-legged frog with a zoo-led breeding and reintroduction program that has released more than 2,000 tadpoles and frogs back to nature in recent years. And now, to tell us more about his herping adventure in the wilds of California and the zoo's critical role in saving the Southern mountain yellow-legged frog, I'd like to introduce Ian Recchio. Welcome, Ian.
Well, hello, everybody. Thanks for tuning in to our California Biodiversity Talk today. I'm going to talk to you a little bit about some California native herps, reptiles. Specifically, I'm going to talk about lizards and snakes today that you can encounter in the LA Basin area, okay? So in the greater Los Angeles area. As Elise alluded to, there's a ton of reptiles and amphibians that are found both native and non-native in our vicinity, but I'm going to focus on the ones that we encounter right on zoo grounds in the wild and ones that you're going to probably encounter in your backyards around Los Angeles. And then after that part of the presentation, I'm going to do a quick update on our mountain yellow-leg frog program, which is going full steam as I speak. We're preparing for another release in a couple of days. And then afterward, you'll all have a chance to type in some questions for me to answer. So let's get started. This is pretty typical habitat in our local mountains here in foothills. You can see some small chaparral type plants and cactus. And then you'll also notice a Pacific rattlesnake, which is a species I'm going to talk about a little more in depth than the others because it's our only dangerously native snake to the LA Basin. And the picture you see there is actually one that was encountered in the wild in Griffith Park. And it's just kind of, you can see in the background there is the city of Glendale. So, you know, right close to all of this, the freeways and homes and cities, we have all these wonderful native animals that you can encounter. So we're going to get on with it now. So the first snake I'm gonna focus on is one that many of you are probably familiar with. It's called the California Striped Racer. It's a harmless snake. And it's quite common around the LA area, especially in the foothills. Anybody that's watching this now that's hiked through our local mountains and foothills has probably seen or at least seen the tail fly by them. As the name implies, the racer is one of the fastest snakes that we have locally. And they are active during the day, so they're one that people often see more than other snakes because they are actively hunting lizards. That's what they like to do. And these striped racers, they usually won't stop to look at you. They'll just crawl away quickly or they'll crawl right across the path in front of you. But it's a really interesting snake. And many of the photographs that I'm going to show you were actually taken right on zoo ground. So these are snakes that occur in Griffith Park and throughout the LA area. So here's one that's also probably familiar to a lot of folks. And this is the California king snake. And this is a particular specimen that we see on zoo grounds. About every few years, he shows up. He's one of our resident California king snakes, and this is the snake that everybody has read about that eats other snakes, and that's how king snakes got their name, right? The king of snakes. So California king snakes are quite common, especially in the coastal area of foothills. We have in the last 26 years, I think I've seen king snakes in the zoo only maybe a half a dozen times, and I think probably most of those times were the same individual. So they're not ultra common in the park of Griffith Park, but they're one that you can see commonly in the basin, but also throughout the deserts of Southern California. And again, this talk is focusing just on the snakes and lizards that we encounter locally, okay? If I was to talk about all the reptiles that you can see going out to our local deserts and then up all the way up into our mountains, we'd be talking till this evening because there's just amazing biodiversity in Southern California. Here's an interesting little critter. This is the ringneck snake. And ringneck snakes eat centipedes, other invertebrates, and small lizards. They are also quite common, and they're one that you probably won't encounter unless you're cleaning stuff up in your backyard and you happen to pick up an old piece of carpet or a board and you find them sitting underneath. They spend most of their time underground, and we have a term for that. It's called fossorial, okay? The fossorial snakes, you just don't encounter them that often. Doesn't mean they're not there. They're there, and they're very common. We see a lot of these in Griffith Park during the springtime, especially after spring rains. If you're out walking around and it gets kind of warm and humid out, and you look underneath logs, and especially that, like I mentioned, they like to go into things like carpet and pieces of plywood, you'll find ringneck snakes. Sometimes you'll find multiple specimens under one piece of debris. And it's a wonderful little snake, and it has a great defense mechanism or warning. I think a lot of folks understand that animals in nature that exhibit bright colors oftentimes are a warning or a flag that says, I don't taste good. Well, the ringneck snake has this kind of olive-colored, generalized color, but when it's disturbed, it curls its tail up, as you can see in the photos, and shows you the underside of its body or the ventral surface, which is this bright orange and red color that's a warning. So I did say I was going to focus on the most common species, and I know this one falls in that category, but they are found in the LA Basin, and they're one that I wanted to focus on because this is the native western blind snake, and they are found in the LA area. They're, again, probably as fossorial as any snake gets. This is an animal that spends 99.9% of its life underground. They like to feed on termite larvae and other invertebrates. But what's also interesting is there's been a non-native thread snake that was introduced to the LA area that was found through some iNaturalist observations that's normally found in Asia. And so there are, and there may be more. These thread snakes, or these blind snakes as they're often called, are found throughout the world, different species, and they oftentimes will stow away in planters of trees. So if somebody, for instance, there's a population of thread snakes on Hawaii that came in when they were building resorts, and they brought in all these palm trees and these plants, and inside of those planters were lots of little thread snakes, and now they're doing really well in Hawaii. So it's a snake that you might encounter if you're digging in your garden, for instance, and all of a sudden you're like, wow, look at this strange worm. And then you look really close and it's got a tiny little eyeball and it starts flicking its tongue at you. And then you know, oh, wow, this is a snake. And of course, this is completely harmless. And it's a great animal to have on your property if you're lucky enough. I'm going to say this particular serpent is probably the one that folks watching this have seen the most. Okay, this is a gopher snake. Specifically, we have in our area the San Diego gopher snake. They are super common, and they are also active quite a bit during the day in the springtime, so people see them when they're hiking, or they might even see them in their backyards. And then as things get hotter, they become what we call, another term, crepuscular, which means that they love to get active right when the sun is going down or when the sun is coming up. So gopher snakes, if you're, again, lucky enough to have this snake in your yard or in your property, it's a wonderful species that eats almost exclusively rodents. It's a major part of our ecosystem as far as rodent and rat control. And unfortunately, its defense mechanism is flattening its head and rattling its tail so that it looks like a rattlesnake. And that often leads to it being killed mistakenly as a rattlesnake. So it does generally resemble a rattlesnake, but it's one that if you see, take a closer look. It should have a nice pointed tail. And that's not to say that, you know, snakes haven't been injured and have lost part of their tail in the wild. But like I said, it's if you take a good look at it and stay safely away, you can pretty much tell a rattlesnake from a gopher snake relatively easily. And then you can see one that's being held by one of our senior keepers at the zoo. He's got a gopher snake that we found just crawling on zoo grounds. And that's very typical of what they look like around the LA area. Okay, so as I mentioned, the Southern Pacific rattlesnake is our only dangerously venomous snake species that's native to Southern California. in the basin. Okay, again, as we go out to areas like Palmdale and Acton, other species of venomous snake, rattlesnakes, start to inhabit those areas. And as you head south down into San Diego, you get a number of other rattlesnake species. But in the basin, this is the serpent, the rattlesnake species that we have. And it varies greatly in color and pattern. And I'm going to show you a few of those. But I'm going to focus a little more on this rattlesnake because it's one that is often killed. And it's very understandable that if you have a dangerous animal in your yard that you may want to kill it or remove it. But what I want everybody to really think about if they see a rattlesnake is that rattlesnakes, they have a number of ways of letting you know they're there, and they'll do everything they can to stay away from you. And I'm going to dispel a few myths right now. Rattlesnakes do not chase you, okay? Rattlesnakes may be so frightened of you that they crawl rapidly towards you in an effort to get away. And that's the truth about these particular animals. They most of the time will lay motionless and hope that you just walk by them. And that's kind of defense mechanism one, number one, right? And then number two is they'll rattle their tail. How many animals can you think of that give you an audible warning to stay away from it? It's really a unique character of rattlesnakes. And then number three is they will crawl away rapidly. And that usually happens when they've either been touched or disturbed, or you've gotten very close to them or mistakenly stepped on one. They will crawl away quickly, and they're so scared that they oftentimes crawl straight towards the thing that they're trying to get away from. So that's kind of what's happening most of the time. This particular species of rattlesnake is also relatively docile. There's a lot of factors that go into how an animal will react to you, and it's hard to cover them all. But snakes being, you know, ectothermic animals, and if they're very warm, they might be more active and easily agitated, as opposed to if they're just getting up in the morning and warming up and still cold. So there's a lot of things to think about. And then finally, with rattlesnakes, including the Southern Pacific, their last resort is to bite you. And, you know, these things do happen. It's a common snake in our area, and they, you know, dogs oftentimes go sniffing them out and get bitten on the nose by rattlesnakes, which is not a good thing. But like I said, in general, they're a relatively docile species that is very important to the ecosystem and feed on lots and lots of rats, which is a good thing. I can tell you, we see a lot of native rattlesnakes in the zoo, and our herpetology department find them and relocate them to a safe area if necessary. And almost every rattlesnake that we find wild on zoo grounds has a rat in its stomach recently eaten. So an important animal for the ecosystem once again. And this is just a cross-section of rattlesnakes, Southern Pacific, same species, different age classes, but all found right in Griffith Park. And the small one that's coiled up on my top right, I think that's the same for you guys, but is a juvenile, and their patterns are generally more vivid and contrasty at this life stage. And then the other two are young adults, and you can see there's some variation to their color and pattern. You can't tell the age of a rattlesnake by its rattle. That's kind of a myth. They do shed their skin several times a year, and each time they do that, they add a rattle. So it's all relative to how fast the rattlesnake is growing. If a rattlesnake is growing rapidly and eating well one year, it may shed three or four times and add three or four rattles in one year. And on the flip side, if it's having a tough year and there's a drought and not a lot of rodents to eat, it may only shed its skin once and add one rattle. And then that rattle might even break off. And so then it's really difficult, of course, to tell anything from it. So just some stuff about rattlesnakes that I thought you all would find kind of interesting. And then I was reluctant to add to our LA Basin species, but I'm going to because I found one in the Hollywood Hills about 30 years ago, and this is the rosy boa. And the rosy boa is, it's uncommon in the LA Basin. It's probably been extirpated from most of its range, but they should still exist in small pockets here and there. They're much more common when you get outside of the LA area and into the desert foothills. And this is a species of boa that's actually only two boa species in California, which is pretty amazing. They are generally ultra docile, and they love to eat rodents. That's one of their favorite things to eat. They're a small species. They don't get more than about 2 feet long. And finally, the king of all king snakes, in my opinion, the California mountain king snake. And these are found at higher elevations. They're more common, not necessarily right in the basin, but I like to include them because if you live, you know, in Santa Monica in the foothills, or you live in La Crescenta in the foothills, you may encounter this snake. And again, this is one of the most beautiful serpents on the planet. I've had herpetologists visit me from all over the world. They come to the lair to see our collection, and they see this California native snake, and they say, wow, we have nothing like this in our country. And it's really true. This is one of the most beautiful animals around. They're not common. They come up and feed on the surface only during very specific temperature times and springtime in particular. They spend most of their time in rock cracks or underground looking for lizards. They are not a king snake that likes to eat other snakes, but they are a king snake. They're not super closely related to the California king snake that I showed you earlier. And most importantly, they're harmless. They're not a coral snake, and they're often killed because, you know, so many people out there think if a snake's got red on it, that means it's a coral snake and it's dangerous. And that's not the case. The only native venomous, dangerously venomous snake that we have in Southern California is the Southern Pacific that I showed you. So this is a harmless snake. And I will tell you, it's never a good idea to pick a snake up if you don't know what you're doing. But if you do pick the California mountain king snake up, it will bite you, almost guaranteed. It doesn't hurt. I've had that pleasure several times in my life. And it's just a way of them defending themselves. Beautiful little snake. Okay, so I am going to touch on some of the lizards from this area. And again, this is one from Griffith Park, right on our zoo grounds. This is the southern alligator lizard. And I'm not going to talk about all the lizards that we can find in the basin because there's a number of them. But I'm going to focus on the ones that you would probably find in your backyard or that would crawl into your house. I probably get 20 calls a year from folks that say, I've got this lizard in my living room and it looks like a snake, but I think it's a lizard. And I've tried to catch it and it's trying to bite me. It's usually the southern alligator lizard. Very common, and they're kind of like the coyote of lizards. They've adapted to just about every environment. They're found, I have them right here in my backyard in Burbank. I found one in the tree recently in our orange tree feeding on bees that were buzzing around the orange blossoms, which was kind of unusual. But they're very common and a wonderful animal. Most of the southern alligator lizards that you'll see will have, they won't have their complete tail. They will have what we call a regenerated tail because they've lost part of their tail as a defense and it's grown back. And you can tell that because the tail is not long like this. It's actually usually short and stumpy, and it doesn't have the original beautiful pattern on it. So you see this kind of dull, stumpy tail on alligator lizards, and that's because of them dropping and regenerating their tail. It's okay, the southern alligator lizard. Probably everybody out there has seen one of these once in their life. This is an unusual one, and I you may never see this in your life. This is an animal that was found right on zoo grounds last year, and this is the California legless lizard. And so all of you are going, well, what makes that a lizard? Well, there's a number of things. They have an ear opening, okay, which is something that lizards have and snakes don't. And they have eyelids, okay? So a little bit different. Snakes don't have eyelids. Most lizards do. And that's one of the ways you can tell. This legless lizard is one, just again, I'm going to use that term fossorial. They are found under the ground or spend most of their life under the ground, and they rarely come to the surface. And we see these occasionally when it rains or, you know, after a spring rainstorm, you might get lucky and see this legless lizard. Really interesting species, one that is kind of a chance encounter. Folks that I know that live around the beach often see legless lizards, and they tend to like to congregate under ice plants is what I've heard, which is kind of wild. The coast horned lizard, okay, probably known to most of you as a horny toad. It is not a toad. It is a lizard. And our coast horned lizard has a really interesting history that I'll talk a little bit about. They are still found in small pockets here and there. Now, they have disappeared from most of their range, and a lot of that is due to the little tiny black Argentine ants that have moved in that we all love to hate so much that come into your kitchen when you leave something out. Those Argentine ants are invasive, and those Argentine ants are aggressive, and they've pushed out or killed many of our native ant species, okay? The red ants that we are familiar with in the area, Those are what the coast horn lizard feeds on. These are what we call myrmecophagous, or specifically ant-eating lizards. So without those native ants, horn lizards do not do well. They need to eat those native ants. They don't eat Argentine ants, or they don't like them. And so that's caused a decline in the populations of this wonderful and super unique family of lizards. And when I say unique, I'm going to tell you, this is truly a unique animal. They are known to squirt blood from their eyes as a defense, which is kind of a strange thing. They are harmless, as harmless can be. And most of the time when people see these horn lizards, because they've kind of scooted across a trail really quickly and hunkered down in the sand or the dirt next to them to try to hide. Wonderful animal. One you probably saw a lot more when you were younger. When I was a kid in the 70s, I used to see these all the time. And it's just right now, it's kind of an unusual sighting. But they are still around in pockets. Here's a couple of lizards that probably most common in our area. Certainly the western fence lizard is the most common. Again, kind of like the coyote, right? They've adapted to every single environment. Folks like to call them the blue belly. That's the animal that you see pictured on the top. And then on the bottom is the side blotch lizard. And right behind that, the forelimb, you see that little black spot near the belly. That's the side blotch that it gets its name from. Both of these are ultra common. Champion feeders of insects. I have some living in my yard. The western fence lizards love to eat mosquitoes, okay? I watched them eat those horrible little zebra-legged mosquitoes, the 80s, that we all are dealing with now. These fence lizards love to eat those, so that's a good thing. And the side blotch lizards are associated with a little bit more deserty type conditions, so they're not as common in the basin, but they are around. And they're very similar looking, you know, from the dorsum, just looking down on them, you go, oh, what kind of lizard is that? But fence lizards are generally a lot bigger, and they're not quite as vibrantly colored along the back as the side blotched. Of course, they do have, the western fence lizard has a bright blue belly, but not all of us get our hands on them or can see that unless they're doing their patented push-ups, as you see this guy here is doing. The coast whiptail, also a relatively common species in the LA Basin. They're easily identified by their extraordinarily long tail and kind of the beautiful long longitudinal orange or yellow stripes that they have on their body. They remind me of our striped racer I talked about earlier. They're ultra fast. They have the same kind of the same kind of habits as the racers. They're active during the day when it's very hot. Not when it's as hot as it is today, but they are active out crepuscular during the summer months looking for insects and things. So it's one that you may see in your backyard if you're lucky enough, especially if you live more near the foothills and not in the middle of the city so much. Okay, so that was all I have for the local lizards and snakes that we encounter here at the Los Angeles Zoo and also around Southern California. But what I do want to talk about for a few minutes is our mountain yellow-legged frog program at the Los Angeles Zoo. This is kind of one of our flagship conservation species. Certainly for my department, it's one of the most important animals that we work with. And I'm going to venture to say that a lot of the folks watching this, unless you've, you know, stayed in tune with what the zoo does, may have never heard of the mountain yellow-legged frog. Mountain yellow-legged frog is one of the most critically endangered small vertebrate animals on the planet, and it's only found in the mountains around Southern California. Okay, the numbers were down to a few hundred in the past 20 years. Okay, a few hundred individuals. So think about that. Found in three giant mountain ranges: the San Bernardino, San Jacinto, and San Gabriel mountains. And there's a long history of kind of a perfect storm of issues that has caused their decline. And some of those issues are things like the chytrid fungus that's killing amphibians, invasive species that are introduced, wildfires, unnatural wildfires that burn their habitat and clog up their waterways. They're found in these pristine mountain environments where the water is just from melted snow and very clean, and they don't tolerate a lot of change. And there's been a lot of change in environment in the last few years. So those are just some of the things that pressured the mountain yellow-legged frog to almost to extinction. You can see we have some eggs in a little petri dish photograph there, which is kind of neat. So About 10 or 11 years ago, we partnered with San Diego Zoo, and now we have Santa Ana Zoo and Henry Dorley Zoo in Omaha, Nebraska, in a program to breed mountain yellowleg frogs and put them back into the wild. And the Los Angeles Zoo has been wildly successful. In the past years, we've put back thousands of tadpoles into the wild, and we have also, we've also put some adult frogs back into the wild. And this year we've put back about 3,000 tadpoles and small frogs that we've raised up back into nature. And we're working on that every year. So this has been a wonderful year for breeding yellowleg frogs. And we're hoping that we continue to have that kind of success. But it's a frog that, you know, again, most of you probably are not familiar with, but it's our frog in Southern California. And probably without zoo intervention and breeding efforts, this animal would be close to or extinct at this point. So, you know, one good example of why zoos matter. So that's all for my short presentation. I think now we're going to allow folks to ask some questions.
Excellent. Thank you for that, Ian. You've certainly had a lot of wild adventures in the wilds of California. We've been getting a lot of great questions from our viewers. Let's go ahead and take some of those. So the first question is gonna be, are blind snakes actually blind?
So the reason they got that name, their vision is very, very poor. We think that they can only see bright and dark type things. They don't really need eyes. That's why they've kind of de-evolved the sight the way they have. So. For all intents and purposes, they are almost blind, as far as we know.
Excellent. Going off of that, here's another one. Do blind snakes and legless lizards dig their way underground, or do they use burrows and tunnels dug by other animals?
Yeah, that's a great question. So both is the answer. The legless lizards tend to gravitate towards sandy kind of environments where they can kind of swim through the sand, and it makes it very easy for them. Blind snakes, we don't know a whole lot about blind snakes, and it's different species act different ways, but they do tend, they do, if you ever hold a blind snake in your hand, the first thing they do is they stick their nose between your fingers and try to dig down between your fingers. So they are quite capable of digging into sand and dirt and mud.
Awesome. So another one, how long have snakes been on the planet, and what is the oldest local species?
Well, you kind of stumped me on that one. There are snake fossils that are being found every single year. And off the top of my head, I can't tell you how many millions of years ago the first snakes appeared on the planet, but it's in the millions of years. They've been around for a long, long time. We have vertebrae of some like Titanoboa, which it makes an anaconda look like a blind snake, okay? So there are some amazing dinosaur-like snakes that have evolved through time. And then you asked me which one was the oldest that we have. I guess you mean by as far as like evolutionary terms, or?
I think they meant like native species that's been in our area, one of the older ones that has been in Southern California.
Yeah, I mean, it's hard to say. I mean, the blind snakes are quite primitive. So that as snakes go, they're probably the most primitive. And then you got rattlesnakes on the other end of the spectrum, which are the most highly evolved, okay? Because they've evolved something as advanced as a poison that is delivered through a venom apparatus, and they also have a rattle on their tail. So they're more recent, as far, evolutionarily speaking, it's rattlesnakes the most recent. Probably blind snakes and boas are some of the older.
Excellent. We've been getting this question a lot. It's an opinion question. What are some of your favorite snake species to work with?
Well, I love that question. I've been asked it a few times before, and I'm a big fan of the viperids. I love pit vipers in particular. Especially the New World pit vipers, which does include the rattlesnake group, the neotropical pit vipers, things like you know, the palm vipers of Mexico and Central America are just spectacular. I like those highly evolved snake species with the bright colors. I'll be honest, I like them because they're pretty too.
One question about the yellow mountain yellow-legged frog population. How do you check on them after you've released the tadpoles?
Yeah, thanks for asking that, because something that I wanted to mention was our other partners besides the zoo, which are the Forest Service, the U.S. Geological Survey, the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Department, and the California Fish and Wildlife Department are all key members of this project. And they are the ones that do more of the post-release monitoring, because us folks at the zoo, our priority is to keep the animals healthy and breeding and producing offspring to put back into the wild. So we really don't have the resources to go back and hike those canyons every day and look for them. And that's the job of, especially the USGS biologists. They hike those release sites and they take a look at how our release animals are doing and if they made it through the winter, et cetera. And so they're doing the post-release monitoring more than we are. Of course, we love to tag along whenever we get a chance.
Excellent. Another one, is it true that baby rattlesnakes are more dangerous than adult rattlesnakes?
Oh, that question.
Yeah.
The broad answer is no. That's kind of a myth. I'm glad you asked the question because I like talking about it. So baby rattlesnakes, what we found out in many species is there's what's called an ontogenetic change in venom composition from being a baby rattlesnake to where they evolve into a large adult rattlesnake. And that venom composition evolves to stop the particular type of prey that they need to kill and eat. And so oftentimes younger rattlesnakes have venom that is different in composition from the adults and could be more toxic. Okay. But that doesn't mean that, let me just give you a perspective. Would you rather be stung by a honeybee that's tiny or a murder hornet that's massive? Okay. So the answer is none of the above, I know, but the deal is an adult rattlesnake, when it bites, has the potential to inject a lot of venom, which is much more dangerous than a smaller rattlesnake. And also smaller rattlesnakes, being babies, like most baby animals, are a little bit more defensive. And so they're more likely to strike and bite. So there's a little bit of truth to that whole myth. But for the most part, you know, I mean, if you were to give me my choice, I would take the baby over the adult almost every time, or none.
That's a good question. What can the public do to help endangered frog species populations in Southern California?
Yeah, I know. I've gotten this question and be responsible when you are hiking and camping in natural places. Don't leave trash behind. Don't go swimming in rivers and streams with all kinds of, products on, because that pollutes the rivers. Don't, if you're fishing, okay, we love to fish. I'm a fisherman myself. If you fish and you catch rainbow trout, don't take those rainbow trout from your fishing hole and hike them upstream to another fishing hole, because we have fish dams that keep the frog habitat separate from the fishing areas. And we've had problems with people moving their rainbow trout from point A to point B, and then all of a sudden they have the potential to eat our tadpoles that we work so hard to release. So that's something. I mean, you know, then I go in the real basic stuff, like, you know, recycle, just be responsible and think about the environment and, you know, what you're taking out of it and what you're putting in. Very, very simple common sense stuff.
We're getting a lot of questions on those frogs. So how long is the cycle from egg to fully formed frog for the yellow-legged frog?
Oh boy, we're still learning, okay? So we worked with two different mountain populations at Los Angeles Zoo. And it's funny, the population from the San Jacinto Mountains took 2 years from an egg to completing metamorphosis, and then another year to grow up into an adult frog. So the process was over 3 years for that population. The San Gabriel Mountain frogs that we're working with now, they seem to complete metamorphosis in about 1 year, and then they're an adult frog in about another year. So it varies. I mean, this is an animal that we're still learning about. And because they come from this colder alpine environment, they grow a little bit slower than, you know, your typical, say, a bullfrog or a tree frog that come from warmer. The yellow-legged frog can only be active and feeding for about 5 months of the year maximum. So you think about it, right? Because their habitat's covered in snow for a good portion of the year. So their cycle's a little bit slower than a typical amphibian.
Yeah. Another question about the frogs. Do you have a problem with any genetic diversity with the frogs since the population was down to the hundreds?
Wow. So is there somebody from a scientist that's planted in this talk asking these questions? So yeah, the answer is yes, we do have, it's a genetic bottleneck. There's no denying that. When you're working with frogs that are found in these tiny little canyons and populations where their numbers have been, decreased to less than one, fewer than 1% of what they should be. Yeah, it's an issue that we look at. And so in order to try to kind of stabilize that, we'll introduce new animals to the breeding group and try to do things to help diversify the gene pool as best we can. But when you're down to the nitty gritty, you don't have a whole lot of choices.
Excellent. I'm trying to find, there it is. Here's another question. I know you touched on this earlier about coral snakes. They're wondering, how can you tell the difference between a coral snake and a king snake? And you touched on it a little bit earlier.
Unless you're a herpetologist or you've studied snakes, the answer is you really can't easily. There's that saying out there, red to yellow will kill a fellow, and red to black is the friend of Jack, or there's a million different variations of it. But there are snakes in Southern California that have a, okay, let me start over. There are no coral snakes that are native to Southern California, first of all. So snakes with red on them are, like I showed you, are probably a mountain king snake with the bright red rings. There are circumstances, this is kind of my caveat to this whole talk, is there people are keeping a lot of exotic snakes at home now and they're escaping. So there are exotic snakes that escape from people's houses, and some of them could be dangerous. So, you know, you never know, so just don't touch them. But coral snakes throughout their range vary greatly. There's coral snakes that mimic king snakes and vice versa. And you have, there's some coral snakes that look almost identical to mountain king snakes. And it's just kind of crazy. But as far as Southern California is concerned, we have that beautiful mountain king snake with the red rings, and they are harmless.
Excellent. Another question here is, can you explain the difference between poisonous and venomous? I think there's a little bit of confusion on that.
Yeah, we use the term venomous for a species that has like a delivery system of the poison, okay? So a fang or a spur or a barb. Okay, so stingrays, right? They have this venomous barb. That's a venomous creature. Snakes have a hollow fang that delivers. Most of them have a hollow fang. Some have a grooved fang. Some just have an enlarged tooth that delivers venom. Poison is used for something that you may eat and ingest, like, you know, a poisonous plant, or we have some frogs that have poison that seeps out of their pores onto their skin. So we call, you know, poison dart frogs, for instance, have that poison on their skin, but they don't have that advanced delivery system that venomous creatures do. Thanks for that question. It's a good one.
Here's another one. Are there any local endangered or threatened lizards?
Oh yeah. So, well, we have, nothing locally that is endangered. There are some night lizards that are found on the Channel Islands that are very much endangered. We have protected species in the desert. There's actually an endangered fringe-toed lizard that's out in the desert. So they're kind of local, but they're not in the LA Basin. And then, of course, you know, our desert tortoise is protected reptile. But as far as other lizards, yeah, you got the fringe-toed lizard. Down in this very southern part of the state, there's a horned lizard, flat-tailed horned lizard that's endangered. It's protected. And then there's been like about a dozen Gila monsters seen on our side of the border. That's mostly in Arizona, Mexico, New Mexico, and Utah animal, and Nevada. But there's a few of them in California that are found down near the Colorado River on our side, and they're also protected. But yeah, we have a few endangered lizards, sure.
Excellent. Just one moment. We have a question. What do snakes eat?
Well, the general answer is they only eat meat, okay? There are no vegetarian snakes that we know about. They, in general, eat whole prey animals. So anything from whole insects, you know, up to, you know, small antelope in some cases. They eat other animals primarily. You know, I've seen snakes eating dead animals on the road, but that's unusual. But they are not vegetarians. There are no salad eating snakes out there.
Another question is there any good ways to attract lizards to our backyard? Like, is there a way to create that habitat for them to make it a safe space?
Yeah, I'm an expert at this because I've got a lot of lizards. I've got more lizards in my backyard than any of my neighbors, and that's because I don't use a lot of pesticides, if at all. I keep a lot of native plants in the back. Now, we don't have a ton of native lizard species that are found right in Burbank, for instance, but we do have the fence lizards and the alligator lizards. So if you have flowering native plants that attract insects, that will in turn attract lizards. Also, you know, and... It, it's really important. I mean, we have a feral cat problem throughout the world, and it's really important that people keep their cats indoors for the benefit of the cat and for the native wildlife. So if you have somebody in the neighborhood that, you know, is feeding a feral cat, they're probably going to eat your lizards, and you're not going to have many lizards, and they're going to eat a lot of your birds too. So cats are a big problem. Feral cats are a big problem. I know it's a touchy subject, but it's a real issue. And so people need to be responsible that way. But by as far as planting your backyard with native plants or just keeping things natural, that usually will encourage insects, and in turn will encourage lots of lizards.
Excellent. So we've gotten this question a lot. What happens, or what should you do if you're bit by a rattlesnake?
Okay, so the answer to that is go to the hospital, because there's really nothing that you can do short of keeping calm and getting anti-venom or getting treatment from a physician for a snake bite. Snake bites are quite rare. There's been a lot of studies done on who gets bitten by snakes, and a large percentage of people that are bitten by rattlesnakes or venomous snakes are trying to kill them. So there's something to chew on for a minute. You know, rattlesnakes' venom is typically not going to kill you in a half an hour. But there are a lot of X factors. Okay. So as long as you get to the hospital and get proper medical treatment, you're going to be fine, or most likely will be fine. One thing I want to talk about real quickly is rattlesnake venom has evolved to kill prey so that it can eat. Okay. We don't think that it's evolved to bite and defend itself. There are other venoms that we think, for instance, Gila monsters, the lizard that's venomous, that venom almost immediately hurts very, very bad. And it's made to make, say, a coyote or a bird of prey that's trying to eat a Gila monster. Remember that if I try to eat this orange lizard and it bites me, I'm going to pay dearly for it with pain. Rattlesnake venom doesn't necessarily work like that. It will be painful. The bite will be painful, but not necessarily immediately. And it's so the snake, there's about a 30% chance roughly that with snake bites, you get what's called a dry bite, because they're biting to defend themselves, not to bite you, kill you, and eat you. So that's one of the good things about it, you know, that you can also get a dry bite. So you don't want to start treating somebody for a snake bite unless you know for sure they've been envenomated. So that's why it's another reason it's important to get to a hospital.
Excellent. Another question is, have you found any snakes with like a modification to normal patterns? Like any, you go for snake instead of having stripes, it's like blotches or any type of abnormalities with patterns?
Yeah, so pattern anomalies are always fun to find in the wild, and I have found a number of those. It's very rare. Most of those pattern and color anomalies you find at the snake shows because people have bred them that way. But in the wild, it's very, very uncommon. I found some striped gopher snakes down in Mexico. I've seen some that are lacking some pattern in some places. I've never had the luck in finding an albino in the wild, which would be kind of wild. But most albino mutations, they don't make it in the wild anyway. So it's just extraordinarily rare. But yeah, a few times I found some unusual pattern specimens here and there.
Excellent. Is there any good ways for the public to be able to help educate more members of their community about the progress on the frogs?
Yeah, just keep in touch with the Los Angeles Zoo. We put out quite a bit of, we do a lot of PR, you know, press releases on extraordinary things that are happening with, you know, like for instance, this Wednesday, we're going to be releasing about 500 more tadpoles into the San Gabriel Mountains. So that's going to be a big deal. But yeah, stay in touch, you know, become a Los Angeles Zoo member, because that's a direct line to what we're doing. You know, we have lots of publications that we put out that talk about all the extraordinary conservation programs that we're involved with, you know, beyond the frogs, the condor program and the peninsula pronghorn program and so many other cool things that we're doing with wild populations. So yeah, become a member and check it out.
Excellent. And we have time for one more question. So this one is from one of our members who is a 7-year-old, wants to know how a whip-tailed lizard uses its tail for defense.
So that long tail on the whiptail lizard is more of kind of like a stability tool, so that when it's running so fast, it kind of moves its tail to keep itself kind of like a rudder on a boat, right? That you move it one way or the other and it kind of steers. It helps keep it on track and keeps it moving. Lizards in general will kind of whip you with their tail if they feel threatened. That is something that they will do. But that's not why they call it a whiptail. They just call it a whiptail because it's long and whip-like. Okay, so that's, I think that's a short answer. That's a great question.
Excellent. Well, thank you all for sending in so many great questions. Sorry, we couldn't get to all of the questions. There's a lot of great ones in the chat, but thank you so much. If you're interested in learning more about California Wild, please join us at 2 p.m. today for a presentation by author Corinne Haining-Laverty on her book, North America's Galapagos, the Historic Channel Islands Biological Survey. You can register for this and check out our other California Biodiversity Day events and activities on our website at lazoo.org/California Biodiversity. That's CA Biodiversity. Thank you all for joining us today, and we hope you have a great day.